welcome to another exclusive RichLifeClub.com interview. We're here today with Russell Friedman. He is the Executive Director of the Grief Recovery Institute Educational Foundation and co-author of The Grief Recovery Handbook, When Children Grieve, and Moving On. Russell, thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome. What a pleasure.
Why did you found the Grief Recovery Institute?
Actually, I'm not the founder. The founder is my partner, John W. James, who founded it 31 years ago, not on purpose. He founded it almost as an accident to save his own life following the death of his three-day-old baby son. And in order to even want to be alive on the planet, he had to find out a better way to deal with the grief that tore his heart right out at the roots. And in an odyssey of trial and experiment of figuring out what would help him, he discovered something that not only helped him, that turned out to have application to other people who had people die, and even application to divorce and other losses. So it was born 31 years ago when a child died. And then I joined John 21 years ago following a bankruptcy and my second divorce, both of which brought me to my knees. So again, I didn't choose to be in that profession. It just kind of chose me, like the death of John's baby chose him. And here it is, what I do. I love doing it. I'm absolutely passionate about it, because every day I get to help people, and I wind up being maybe the happiest person I know. And so it's fascinating, because people say, isn't it painful? Isn't it depressing dealing with other people and their grief? And I say, no, it's uplifting, because everyone I ever talk to feels better. I don't necessarily get to help them be complete with their grief every time, but at least they have hope that something is possible. So every day is uplifting for me, and the more difficult their problems, the better I feel when I can help them.
So in working with people who are going through grief or loss, most people think of the five stages of grief, but you have a different take on that.
Yes, the famous non-existent stages of grief that everybody thinks exist. It's interesting, as I just, it's November of 2008, and just recently a major magazine called Skeptic Magazine published a very long article I wrote debunking the stages of grief entirely. Not to be mean or malicious, but I've personally talked to 100,000 grieving people. And as you may know, I think you may have referenced the fact that the first stage that people talk about, the stages, is denial. Okay, I've talked to 100,000 grieving people. I have yet to meet one who's in denial that a loss happened. My first interaction, I answer the phone, I say, Grief Recovery Institute, and they say something like, what do you do there? And I say, we help people deal with death, divorce, and other losses. They say, oh. And I say, what happened? They say, my mother died, or my son died, or my husband left me. And they immediately, rather than saying they're in denial that a loss happened, they tell me what loss happened. And they often start crying. So I have yet to meet anyone in denial that a loss happened. And everybody who tries to twist the idea of denial to mean something else, it doesn't mean anything else. If I ask them what happened, they tell me. Here's the funny way to look at it. Ask a funeral director sometime if he ever got a call that went like this. Hi, Jones Funeral Home. Yes, there's a vague possibility that my mother died, and if that's true, would you send a wagon to pick up the body? And people can't see you, but you're laughing. They'll laugh and go, it doesn't happen that way. They call up and say, my mommy died. So just starting with the first alleged stage of grief, there isn't one. None of the others exist either. But what's really interesting is the original stages that were defined by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross were not called stages of grief. They were originally defined as stages of dying. And what is about was what the stages you might go through if you're told you have a terminal illness, which is totally different than what happens to me if my mother dies or someone dies. In fact, what's interesting too is that when Elizabeth wrote her first famous book called On Death and Dying, the original language was the stages of receiving catastrophic news, which later got shifted to stages of dying. Then, over the years, over the last 40 years, it morphed and it morphed. And no one was around like me and my partner to say, wait a minute, there are no stages of grief. Those were stages of dying in the first place, and even those are questionable or marginal. They may or may not be true, but there's no stages of grief. There's nothing so repetitive that relates to all or even most people where they would go through a series of five stages. So if people are interested, then go get Skeptic Magazine and read it, and they can go to our website, www.grief.net. It's posted right there. You can read it, no charge. There's also, this month, November of 2008, Scientific American published an article that features a whole story about my article. So we're finally starting to get a lot of mention in national media because Scientific American has a pretty big circulation, I think 700,000 or 800,000 people. So, and so we're like 31-year overnight successes. People are finally catching up to that what we say makes sense. And let me just tell you, the reason stages are dangerous for grieving people is they stop people from doing anything. So if someone tells you're in denial when you're not, it freezes you so you don't get the help you need. If someone tells you you're in the anger stage when you're not, in any kind of stage, it stops you from doing it, and you wait for that stage to end. But since there aren't any stages, they can't end. So it paralyzes the griever into not doing anything.
So if the first reaction in grief isn't denial, maybe it's something like, no, 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 I don't want this to happen, or it's not happening. If it's not denial, what would you call that?
What you're describing there would be when it's a shocking, sudden death. What you just described with, oh, no, no, it can't be true. That people don't have that in the circumstance if you've been attending to someone who's ill a very long time and visiting them in the hospital every day for weeks or months. And when they finally die, that won't have the same reaction, that disbelief. In fact, there'll be a lot of other feelings. Some might be relief that your loved one's no longer in pain, which would be one feeling. You're still devastated they're gone. But there won't be any disbelief. And there won't be shock. Shock is a rare medical condition that happens often when a child dies suddenly, when there's like you get a call and your son has been killed in an accident. That could actually shut your system down entirely for a short time. The most common reaction, though, is upon awareness or receipt of the news that someone dies, the first kind of, let me call it a non-feeling that most people would be numbness. That is almost universal. You can even have that in reaction to a divorce or notification of a divorce and so on. But numbness is almost universal. Not quite, but close. The one thing that is universal is after the numbness wears off, after you come out of what I call the emotional Novocaine, when the circuit breaker comes back on and there's some light in your house, so to speak, that what will happen is you will still have a tremendous difficulty concentrating. And lack of concentration or focus is probably the closest thing to 100% universal. Not everybody, but as close as possible that everyone will have that. And that's like you're in one room, you decide to go in another room to do something. When you get there, you go, huh? What am I doing here? And that's almost every grieving person can relate to that. And again, it doesn't matter if it's a death or a divorce or another loss they're grieving. So you have what's not a stage, it's a typical physiological reaction, inability to concentrate or focus, not a stage. Then there's two other really common reactions. You might have tremendous difficulty with eating. You know, you might either not be able to eat or not stop eating. You go back and forth between either extreme. You either can't sleep or you can't get out of bed and back and forth between those. Those are really typical. And the last commonality for most grieving people is a roller coaster of emotions, highs, lows, and then bottom dropping out, way high, and then neutral times, almost like where you almost don't remember, and then it comes back and zap you in the gut, or you have some sweet memories, and you may cry, but they're warm and happy memories. So none of those are stages. They're the typical reactions to loss, and part of our life's work at the Grief Recovery Institute is to get the idea of stages away, so the more human things can be talked about, like we just talked about. I would imagine that you would see that that's really normal, those eating and sleeping and all those things, and yet they're not stages, and they're not universal. The truth is there are no stages. And one of the things that stages does is it destroys something really important. Every relationship that has ever happened on Earth is unique. There are no exceptions. That's why if someone says they know how you feel, the answer is no, you don't. Because of my unique relationship, even if you're a widow or if you have some loss parallel to mine, you don't really understand me, you understand you. We might be able to relate to each other, but there's no universal truth. And when stages rob the truth of your uniqueness and put you in a lump that is never true, you are a unique person with a unique reaction to the death of your person, where your unique relationship you had with them and your unique relationship to what you know about grief. So it's a whole package deal, and you can't stage someone. You dehumanize them because it's not accurate.
If grief is unique and every experience of grief is unique, is there a universal way to recover from grief?
Our book, The Grief Recovery Handbook, has a subtitle. The subtitle really answers the question, which is, the ACTION program for moving beyond death, divorce, and other losses. And the key is the word action. And more beyond that is, what actions do you need to take to help you discover and or discover and complete what's left emotionally unfinished when someone dies? And those actions are universal. They work for all losses. They work for everybody. There's not a different set of actions for different people, nor a different set for different losses. And really what it is that any relationship, no matter what, when it ends due to death or divorce or estrangement, there are always things we wish had happened different, better, or more. That is, things we wish we'd said or not said, things we wish the other person had said or not said, or done or not done. That's universally true for everybody, no matter what. No matter how they died or what the relationship was, good or bad or ugly or mixed, it's going to be different, better, or more. And then there's another category, which has a surprising twist to it, that there's always unrealized hopes, dreams, and expectations for the future. Even if someone's 95, you'd want them to be 96. If you had, for example, you get married to go off in the sunset together, divorce ends that hope and dream. And then you have a situation where if you have a terrible relationship with someone, say an alcoholic parent or sibling or something like that, and they die, what does the death do? It robs you of the hope of repairing the damaged part. So in grief recovery, the universal set of actions helps people discover what all the missing things, all the unfinished things, hopes, dreams, and expectations, different, better, more, and then puts the discoveries of unfinished things into certain categories so we can communicate, obviously indirectly. We never do grief recovery directly, even with a living person. We always do it indirectly because there's some things. If you have to forgive someone, you have to do it indirectly. Can't forgive someone to their face. So let's do a sidebar here. A forgiveness is an attack. Yes, you make a funny face when I say that. I'll tell the world you just did that. And because it's a confusing line. A forgiveness is an attack. It's a confrontation. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Are you carrying a gun? No, good, because now I can ask the question. Because if you're carrying a gun and I do this, watch this, you're going to want to shoot me. You know, Christine, you've always been a real jerk, but I'm Mother Teresa, so I forgive you. Aren't you glad you don't have a gun? Aren't I glad? Because what I did by forgiving you was attack you. All forgiveness is an attack. Some people for years were sent by their therapist or 12-step sponsor or religious coach or clergy. They were sent to confront their parents. They said, when you did this when I was a kid and you really destroyed my life. Now, that confrontation does not create completion. It actually creates a new war. Because your little parents say, how dare you? Who changed your diapers? Who put you through college? They're not going to say, oh, thanks for telling me what a bad parent. I really appreciate you sharing that with me. And trust me, you can't go ahead and say, well, you know, it's kind of spiritual. I've been kind of looking inwards and doing some investigation. I realize that you really hurt me, and I want to forgive you for that. And the person says, not so fast. And even if your little old mother goes, oh, okay, honey, she's resenting the heck out of you because you've just attacked her. All forgiveness is an attack. So all emotional completion, which automatically has to include forgiveness, has to be indirect. Obviously, it's indirect if you're dealing with a person who's died. If they're living, though, you have to do it indirect because you can't go, in order for me to get emotionally complete, I can't slap you in the face. So I know it surprised the heck out of you, and I'm glad, and I hope anyone watching this is surprised, because we need them to understand that forgiving someone in person is a wrong thing to do, yet forgiving someone is the most essential thing, and it has to be indirect. Now, there has to be a witness. So there's a whole process of actions that we teach people in grief recovery on discovering all the unfinished business, then putting it in the categories, including forgiveness and apologies, and then communicating in a certain indirect way so that they can finally be complete. Otherwise, and the people you've seen who seem to be carrying grief around forever, they've never had a chance to finish the unfinished business. So they just keep looping their story.